All right. So we were at the sustained inflation maneuver, also called as a continuous CPAP maneuver. Now, how do you do the continuous CPAP maneuver? You will convert whatever mode of ventilator you are to a pressure support mode. Okay. On the pressure support mode, you will increase the PEEP to 30. You will make the pressure support zero and you will increase the PEEP to 30. So when you increase the PEEP to 30, you look at your timing and just wait. Just wait. As you wait for 30 seconds, around 30 to 40 seconds, the lungs should ideally get recruited. And once they get recruited, you go back to your original settings. This is called as the CPAP sustained inflation. Once more, patient, you have intubated, you have ventilated. Now you feel that you want to recruit this patient. What do? You paralyze the patient, ensure there is no hypovolemia, ensure there is no hemodynamic embarrassment. At that moment, you will just convert your pressure support. You will keep the patient on pressure support and then you will increase the PEEP to 30. After increasing the PEEP to 30, you will wait for around 30 to 40 seconds. Once you wait for 30 to 40 seconds, then you go back to your original mode. That is called as sustained inflation technique. Hello? Not audible. Okay. Not audible, ना? वही मेरे को जरा इंटरनेट कनेक्शन वापस चेंज करना पड़ेगा मेरे को मेरा मी अ मिनट मैं अभी कर देता हूँ ठीक है
ऑडिबल ऑडिबल है
ओके सो यू कैन हियर मी नाउ राइट
Yes, sir.
All right. Just a minute. Let me just mute everybody because otherwise I can't understand what's happening. All right. So that is called as a sustained inflation. So if you understand clearly, what happens with a sustained inflation is that there is a sudden increase in the pressure. A. Okay. B, it is only for 30 to 40 seconds. And C, you go back to your original settings. This means to say you are not figured out what your PEEP is, what is your optimal PEEP. Your lungs are opening up and that also it is suddenly opening up. Okay. That means the pressure in the alveoli units may suddenly go up. Okay. And the second thing is you are doing it only for 30 seconds. And the third thing is that you are going back to your original settings, which might be not your optimal PEEP in the first place. You understand? So this means your sustained inflation is going to improve oxygenation only for a short while. It may go back to the original condition. It might also be an extremely, extremely dangerous thing to do because there is a sudden rise in pressure. Am I clear on this? Okay. A sustained inflation technique, which is the simplest technique to do, may not work. A, because of the fact that studies have proven that the sustained inflation works only for the first 10 seconds. After 10 seconds, whatever is happening is an injurious form of ventilation or injurious form of pressure that is increasing in the lungs. And this might not really help the patient. We initially thought that if we once blow up the lung will remain open, but you give a PEEP so that the lung doesn't collapse. Now here, what are we doing? We are going back to your original settings. Your original settings, do you know what PEEP you are? Do you know whether the lung is inflated? Do you have any of these answers? You don't have any of these answers. Since you don't have any of these answers, there is a high possibility that the lung after some time will just go down. And then all your problems will come up. Are we clear on this? That is why the sustained inflation maneuver is not a great maneuver for recruitment. Okay. So which is the other maneuver that can help you in recruitment? The other maneuver that can help you in recruitment is called as a staircase maneuver. Okay. The staircase maneuver is something that takes time but yields much better benefit as compared to the sustained maneuver, at least by what we are talking, you'll understand why. All right. Now, what is the staircase maneuver? What is the staircase? Slightly, sir, you keep going up, 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 up. This is what is the staircase. So similarly, the staircase maneuver is also a condition in which you go up on the peep. Now, what is the driving pressure? Driving pressure is plateau pressure minus peep. That is your driving pressure. We know very well that we want to keep our driving pressure at 15. We don't want the driving pressure to go more than 15. Am I clear on this? When I'm doing my pressure controlled ventilation, whatever pressure that I'm setting in pressure control is equal to the plateau pressure. Whatever pressure control I'm setting, for example, if I set my pressure control at 10, then my plateau pressure is 10. If my pressure control is 20, then my plateau pressure is 20. Okay, you don't need to do a plateau pressure maneuver during a pressure controlled ventilation, because whatever pressure you are setting is your plateau pressure. Clear on this? So if I set my pressure control at 20, means my plateau pressure is 20. Okay, now if I set my am I clear till now about pressure control? Okay, so initially what we talked was, we went from ventilation in sustained inflation, from ventilation to CPAP or pressure support. Now we are going to go from whatever ventilative mode to your pressure control mode. You're going to your pressure control mode because I want to control my driving pressure and by staircase maneuver increase the pressure inside the plateau. In short, what am I doing? I'm increasing my transpulmonary pressure, because transpulmonary pressure is plateau pressure minus peep. So as I'm going to increase my pressure control, I'm increasing my plateau pressure. As I'm increasing my plateau pressure, my transpulmonary pressure is going to go higher and higher. Clear on this till now? Clear on this? Now, what do I do here? In order to ensure that I'm not harming the lung, I keep my driving pressure constant. So what do? If I'm at 20 pressure control and 5 peep, what is my driving pressure? 15. My driving pressure is 15. If I'm at 20 and 5, my driving pressure is 15. Clear? Now when I go up from 5 to say 7, my pressure control will go to? What will go to? It will go higher. You will maintain a 15 gap. So if my pressure, if my peep is 10, what will be my pressure control? 25. You understand? If my peep is 10, my pressure control will be 25. If my peep becomes 15, my pressure control will become 30. If my peep becomes 20, my pressure control will become 45. Because I am maintaining my driving pressure at 15. I don't want my driving pressure to go up. So when you're doing a staircase maneuver, I will go in steps of peep, but I'll maintain a driving pressure of 15 with my pressure controlled ventilation. Am I clear what I'm saying? Am I clear? Understood, right? So for example, I start my, if I kept my peep of 10, I intubated, ventilated and kept my peep of 5. Say for example, I kept my peep of 5. So my first step will be 5 of peep, 20 of pressure control, respiratory rate, whatever, 15, 20, 18, whatever you want, keep that. FiO2, whatever you want to keep. Keep the FiO2, whatever, if it's 80, 80, if it's 90, 90, if it's 100, 100. Okay, keep whatever FiO2 you have. Keep the IE ratio, whatever, 1:2, whatever you have, 1:2 ratio, keep the 1:2. Okay, but what I'm going to do, I'm going to keep my pressure control of 20 and my peep of 5, and I'll wait for around 3 to 5 minutes. Okay, I will wait for around 3 to 5 minutes. Clear on this? Now, the next step is, I will increase now my peep to say 10. Okay, I will increase to 10. What will I increase my pressure control to? 25. When I increase my pressure control to 25, my driving pressure is 15. And now I'll wait at this stage for another 3 to 5 minutes. Okay, then I will go from 25 and I will make that 30. When I make my pressure control 30, what will be my peep? My peep will be 15. So my driving pressure is maintained at 15. What am I doing? I'm maintaining my driving pressure but trying to increase my transpulmonary pressure. This is what I'm doing. Okay, and as I'm going up, when I reach 30, when I reach 35, what will be my peep? My peep will be 20. Okay, so as I'm doing this, what am I looking at? What am I going to monitor? When I'm doing, so this means this staircase maneuver is an exhaustive maneuver for you. It is a maneuver that will require you to be bedside for a period of around 30 to 35 to 40 minutes. You cannot really just give a staircase maneuver, you know, just do it like a CPAP. CPAP will take you 30 seconds, 40 seconds. Whereas this is going slowly and steadily, it is going up, slowly and steadily it is going up. Okay, then you will reach a peep of say 25. Okay, and then as you go higher and higher, there will be a characteristic rise of your oxygenation and a characteristic rise on your compliance. So as you're doing this, you're also monitoring your compliance and you're also monitoring your SpO2. You're monitoring your compliance and you're monitoring your SpO2. Compliance is as a button, it is there on the ventilator. You can see the C over there. Compliance will show on the ventilator as a C over there. So say, for example, you are at 5 and you are at 20. Okay, 20 of pressure control, 5. You'll see the compliance. You will see your saturation. Then you will go from 20 to 25 and you'll increase your peep to 10. Okay, then again you'll see your compliance. You'll again see your saturation. You know, for 5 minutes, this is what it is. 3 to 5 minutes. Okay. And as you're doing this, there will be a combination where your compliance goes up. Your compliance is going up. Okay. And your oxygenation also is going up. You will find that part somewhere where the compliance has started to go up and the oxygenation has gone up. Once your compliance starts going up and your oxygenation starts going up, you can reasonably assume that probably I'm at my point, I've opened up my alveoli, and this is the point where the recruitment has started occurring. Am I clear on that? Am I clear? Okay. Now, once you see that going up characteristically, and as I told you, you need to go up on the transpulmonary pressures. You might reach a pressure control of 35 or 40. You might reach a pressure control of 45. Okay. Assuming that the ARDS lung will have a 17 of pleural pressure. If you assume the ARDS lung has got a 17 of pleural pressure, how much should your minimum pressure control be in order to recruit, Elizabeth? I'll repeat the question once more. Your ARDS lung, I am assuming, now I have not put a transpulmonary catheter inside. I am assuming that the patient has got ARDS. When in my assumption of ARDS, my pleural pressure will be around 17. My pleural pressure will be around 17. This is my assumption. Okay, approximately 17. So what should be my transpulmonary pressure, okay, or my plateau pressure where I will elicit some form of recruitment? What is the estimate that I'm making? As I told you, transpulmonary pressure should reach above 15, above 18, 20. It should not be 12. It should be 18, 20. So what should it be? So transpulmonary pressure, what is it? Tell me. Unmute yourself.
The transpulmonary pressure should be kept more than 18. So I will add it to the pleural pressure. That will give me how much of P-plat I can.
Yeah. How much should you reach now? If you want, say 20 plateau, 20 transpulmonary pressure, how much do you want?
Around 37.
Yeah, it should go up to 37. It should be 37, 40, isn't it? So you will want to reach somewhere around 40. So your pressure control setting, you need to reach somewhere around 40. You know, you can't just leave it at that. So you will reasonably estimate that your pressure control will go to 35, 40, and your peep will be somewhere around, say, more than that, whatever it is. I don't know. Might be more than that, but that is the point you're going to figure out, ki where your oxygenation is going up and where your compliance is going up. That point you're going to figure out. Okay. Once you've reached a reasonable setting for 5 minutes, then you have reached a peep of say 18, 19, 20, whatever it is. You must understand mild, moderate and severe ARDS. In mild ARDS, usually the settings are 5 to 10 peep. In moderate ARDS, the setting is usually 10 to 15 peep. And in severe ARDS, the settings are 15 to 20 peep. More than 20 peep are generally supposed to be injurious unless you have transpulmonary pressure. Okay, unless your transpulmonary pressure. So zero to five, that's the mild, moderate, severe. So you're going to be on the higher peeps when you're on severe ARDS for certain. Okay, so now once you reach that level, you leave it at that level for five minutes and then you start now coming down. Same similar strategy, you start coming down. If you are at 20 peep and you are at 35 pressure control, okay, you will come down to 30 of pressure control and 15 of maybe 222. By 222 you'll come down now. Now, you know, you went up by 555, but you'll come down by say 222. You can go up also by 222. But you come down slowly. You don't come down fast. Why do you want to come down slowly? As you're coming down, there will be a situation where suddenly the oxygenation will go down by around 1 to 2% on saturation and your compliance will suddenly go down. Okay, that particular point is your de-recruitment point. Okay, that is your de-recruitment point. You want to keep your PEEP above that point. You want to keep your PEEP above that point. Clear on this? So you have reached say 40 and you have reached 25. Okay, say your PEEP. Now you come down 40, so make it 38, make 25, 23. From 38 to 36, that 23 will become 21. As you're coming down, there will be a point where the saturation suddenly goes down, and you're doing it for five minutes. It's not sudden. 5 minutes, dekh rahe ho aap kya ho raha hai? Samajh mein aa raha hai? Three to 5 minutes, you're watching it. Okay, you're watching it, and suddenly when it starts going down in that 3 to 5 minutes, you know, for you have a kind of a subjective estimate that probably your PEEP is around that level. So once you have reached that level, you have de-recruited the lung. You have to again re-recruit your lung. You have to again reach that levels and then leave the PEEP at that. You again go back to slowly go back to 30, or you do a sustained inflation and quickly come back to the PEEP that you have decided, to more than what you have decided. Clear on that? Am I clear? Niharika, you understood? Huh? Everybody understood what? Prasad, you understood what? Yeah. Yeah, so that's called as the staircase maneuvers. Okay, now what did you understand? What is the big difference between the staircase maneuver and sustained inflation? The sustained inflation takes time. It does not take time at all. Whereas the staircase maneuver takes time. A sustained inflation suddenly goes up to a high pressure, which may be injurious. Here, you're not suddenly going up. You're going up slowly. So the injury pattern to the lung is much, much lesser. Because as I told you, recruitment means you are injuring the lung. So now you are trying to reduce the injury that you're causing to the lung by going slowly up. The third thing you can understand is you are coming back to a setting where the lungs will not further collapse. You're coming back to a setting where the lungs will not further collapse, because now you have found out the PEEP at which the lungs will not further collapse. Have you understood? So you've done three important things when you're doing a staircase maneuver. You're subjecting the patient to a very high pressure, but you're doing it very, very slowly to ensure that you're not injuring the lung. This is called as a staircase maneuver. Now, why is it that you have to wait for 3 to 5 minutes? There were studies that was done between each setting. You should wait for 3 to 5 minutes, because what normally occurs is that in recruitment strategies, the effect starts coming somewhere at 5 minutes. The effect of your recruitment strategy or your change in PEEP, if it is increased or decreased, comes in 5 minutes. You can't do it less than 5 minutes. That is what the statement says. That's why we are saying 3 to 5 minutes. You understand? That is what the studies say. That's why we are saying 3 to 5 minutes. You got the point? So you have to wait. You cannot do it immediately and go up fast. You can't do that. That is not the way it is supposed to be done, because the effect of your change in PEEP will come somewhere at 3 to 5 minutes, and it is sustained for 55 minutes. It is sustained for 55 minutes. So effect of PEEP will be sustained for 55 minutes. What alteration that you have done will be sustained for 55 minutes. This is what we know. Okay, similarly, when you're decreasing PEEP also, your change in PEEP will again drop your compliance or change your oxygenation at 5 minutes and will sustain itself for around 55 to 60 minutes. And that is why the alteration that you have to do is somewhere between 3 to 5 minutes. It is very scientific. If you do it less than that, if you do it at 1 minute, you will probably not get the effect. That is why all your PEEP maneuvers that you have done, you might have a situation where the oxygenation is not improving, but the compliance is improving. Okay, when the compliance is improving, the effect will come at 60 minutes. That means at 5 minutes, you can assume that if your oxygenation started going up, you can assume, wow, there is something happening. And that effect you'll get at 60 minutes. At 5 minutes, if you're not seeing an improvement, then at 60 minutes also, there'll be no improvement. You understand? So if you're going up on your PEEP and you've gone from 5 to 10 and you've seen a characteristic improvement in oxygenation, you can assume that the full effect will come in 60 minutes. That means at 60 minutes after doing my changes, I will see the best effect. That's why if you see normally, after we recruited your lung, you come after 1 hour, things have all changed. Things have become much better. You've seen that, right? You've seen that. Once you have got a higher PEEP, you come after an hour, everything has kind of improved, because the effect of PEEP is seen after 1 hour. Clear on this? Am I clear on this? That's why it's imperative for you to, after you have done all your maneuvers, to come back and revisit your maneuvers to understand whether I'm right or wrong, whether the compliance is okay or not, whether the FRC is improved or not. These are the things that I'm going to question after you've done a recruitment maneuver. It's very important to question yourself when you do your recruitment maneuvers. Clear on this? Am I clear? So sustained inflation. Yeah, Prasad, unmute your mic and let me know if there's something you want to ask.
Yes, sir. Sir, we are saying this 60 minutes. This is after the after achieving this optimal pitch, which is required for wait for 50 to 60 minutes after that, after full procedure is done.
Yeah. So you might get an oxygenation to improve at 92. Say, suppose you had started your recruitment maneuver, and at recruitment maneuver, you've reached from 84, 85 to 88, 89. Don't feel that 88, 89 will ruk jayega. Uska full effect will come at 60 minutes. So even if it's 88, after some 60 minutes, when you test your compliance, test your oxygenation, you'll see a remarkable change in the compliance. You'll see a remarkable change in the oxygenation, which will be more than 2 to 3%. Clear on this. So that's why as a bedside doctor, at 1 hour, you should time yourself to come and do this. At time yourself, like yesterday. It's a clear example of yesterday's... let me just read it out what they sent me yesterday. Okay, so yesterday what happened was they did a recruitment maneuver on one of our patients by the name of Lakshman Narvekar. Okay, now when they did that recruitment maneuver, one of our patients, let me just, I don't know how to open the gallery here. 1 minute. Where is my gallery here? They sent me the image, WhatsApp image of this patient. Whatever happened was, over a period of time, you did find that after 1 hour, when they repeated it, the compliance improved, the oxygenation improved when they did all that. So that's why you should revisit what has happened on that side. You should revisit. So this is about recruitment maneuvers. Now, in our ventilator, this staircase maneuver can be done very easily. In our ventilator, which is the G ventilator, is there on the G ventilator. Other ventilators will not give you the trend. The G ventilator give you a trend. If you go to something called as peep in view, there is the FRC in view and there is a peep in view. The first time you do the FRC the right way. The second time, once, say for example, now you have recruited your patient, you have found out with the FRC, what is happening and all these things. Now, after a couple of hours, the tube gets disconnected. Your tube gets disconnected, or the nurse does a suction, or there is a sudden change in the behavior of the patient. You are assuming that the recruitment has failed and de-recruitment has occurred. Now you want to re-recruit this patient. That is why when you go to your machine again and you go peep in view, there are some buttons over there which says start peep, end peep, and time. So that means if you start at 16 peep, okay, that was, say for example, you found your optimum peep is 16. You can go from 16 peep to 30 peep slowly over 5 minutes, and then that will recruit your lung again and get you back to 16 peep. That is the meaning of the peep in view there. Okay, there's a peep in view in that. So that is the meaning of the peep. So once you have found out your optimal peep, then it is very easy for you to actually come back and re-recruit your lungs. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Clear on this? That's the peep in view. Next time you go to the G ventilator, look at the peep in view and you'll understand that you can do a simple maneuver after you have found out your optimal peep. Okay, we have not gone into optimal peep. We are just talking about recruitment maneuvers as of now. Okay, are we clear now how to recruit? Any queries here? Any queries, Prasad? Any queries?
Sir, I have one question.
Yeah, who is Akanchan? Yeah, tell me.
Sir, wo sustained inflation technique mein pressure support kitna rakhna?
Zero. Pressure support will be zero. Your pressure support will be zero. Patient is not going to breathe. Your peep will be 30 and you're going to monitor that for 30 to 40 seconds. That is a sustained inflation. But will you now do your sustained inflation? What is a better maneuver? The better maneuver is definitely staircase maneuver. Now that you know what the staircase maneuver is, how do you do the staircase maneuver? Once more, you convert from normal ventilation, whatever tidal volume ventilation, to pressure control. After going to pressure control, maintain a driving pressure, go up on the transpulmonary pressure by increasing the plateau pressure or the pressure control. Go up to the setting where the oxygenation improves, the compliance improves. This will be somewhere around 40. Okay, once you do that, then you start slowly coming down in steps of 3 to 5 minutes. As you come down, there'll be a point where there's going to be de-recruitment. There's going to be a reduction in compliance and a reduction in oxygenation. That is a de-recruitment point. You re-recruit the patient and keep it 2 above that peak. That is the meaning of staircase maneuver. So on an average patient, this will take you 45 minutes. It is not possible to recruit your patient in 5 minutes time. It will take you 45 minutes, 40 to 45 minutes. That is why you need to spend time with a patient who's on recruitment maneuvers. Clear on this? Clear? Am I clear? Clear? Huh? Okay. Prasad, you have a query?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Once this process is done of recruitment and we've revisited the patient after 60 minutes, we've found after that for returning for reducing the peep, then sir, we'll keep on reducing. If suppose his target, our targets are achieved, TP is maintained within less than 15 and so we can start reducing the peepness after
one hour. So if you are safe, don't reduce anything. For example, what is safe? Safe means if your transpulmonary pressure is less than 12, if your, that is called as a transpulmonary pressure, which is called as stress, is less than 12, if you're monitoring with an esophageal catheter, if your TPP, that is transpulmonary pressure, the calculations were done yesterday, please see the calculations. If you don't have it, take it from, I think Akash or somebody, who has it, which respiratory therapist sent it to me yesterday? Who sent it to me?
Ashish.
Ashish, okay.
It's in the file.
Okay, it's in the file of Lakshman Darvekar. Look at that. Look at that. That readings that was there, and understand transpulmonary pressure. If your TPP is less than 12, if it is less than 12, you are safe with respect to pressure or with respect to stress. If your tidal volume divided by FRC, if your tidal volume divided by FRC is less than 0.25. is less than 0.25, you are safe with respect to strain. So if you are on both these sides, that your stress and your strain is well maintained, strain less than 0.25 and stress less than 12, you can keep whatever PEEP you want lesser than that. It is not going to make a problem. Going higher than that can be an issue. Okay. Yeah. Yes, Prasad.
Yes, sir. And sir, if suppose strain, we are not able to achieve the strain for yesterday's Narvekar patient, sir. His strain, those SpO2, all this, it improved. But sir, his strain was going up and up only.
No, strain was 0.21. Strain, what you have sent to me shows strain of 0.21. Yesterday, the strain that you sent to me was...
Yeah, sir. It was initially 0. But after that, it has raised to 0.5 also, 0.53, 0.51.
No, but after you have recruited, when we repeated the measurements, it was 0.25. Mereko jo, what you have sent to me. What you have sent to me shows point. Yeah, go ahead. Tell me.
Yes, sir. If suppose this strain is increasing, sir. So that means, sir.
If the strain is increasing, what is the meaning? That your functional residual capacity, FRC, is very low. Since your FRC is very low, that means to say your baby lung is very small or your end expiratory lung volume is very small. Now, you must understand that compliance into the change in PEEP is increase in volume. So, for example, your compliance is say 12, okay, and you have changed the PEEP from 5 to 10. That means there's a 5 change. So, compliance into 5, 12 into 5 is 60. So your tidal volume should, your end expiratory lung volume should increase by 60. Anything more than 60 is recruitment. So if you find that, you know, you're increasing your PEEP, but there is no recruitment happening, means this lung is not going to open. It is very difficult to open this lung. This is a candidate where you'll have to give prone position.
Okay.
You understand?
Yes, sir. And sir, initially, the FRC, sir, initially it was 2,200 initially, and after that it has dropped to 884.
That's okay. So we are not concerned. We are not concerned with improving. Your baby lung may be 200 ml. You have gone to 1,000 plus. You know, when you've gone to 1,000 plus, your FRC by tidal volume by FRC will improve. No. You understand? So you need to come down on your tidal, you need to come down on your FRC so that your strain is maintained. You understand? So either you increase your FRC, but you keep your strain less than 0.25 and the transpulmonary pressure less than 12. Once you do that, then you're okay.
So, sir, we can also reduce the tidal volume.
What happens is, if you reduce your tidal volume, then you have another thing you have to think about is your ETCO2. Okay. If you reduce your tidal volume, say from 400 to 300, you know, once you reach less than 4 ml per kilogram body weight, you might be ventilating the alveolar, the dead space. The dead space is 150 ml usually. So if you reach 300 ml, that means the actual tidal volume that is going inside the patient is only 150 ml usually. Okay. So that 150 ml will not cause ventilation. It will not cause carbon dioxide to go out. So that can be quite disastrous for you. So you have only two options, either to improve the FRC or give the patient prone ventilation. That is how it is. Okay, that is the only way you can improve this kind of a condition. Okay, so but you should, this is all something that you have to learn over a period of time. You can't do it in one jhatka. There is no formula for it. You have to slowly understand how to do these things. Clear on this?
Yeah, sir. So again, the same change will happen in ETCO2. ETCO2, if we're reducing the tidal volume, then ETCO2 will keep on increasing, sir.
Yes, that is a problem. ETCO2
will increase, yeah.
That is a problem. So that is why just reducing your tidal volume is not the answer. The answer is to actually improve the FRC. And if you want to improve the FRC, the only way is to recruit them by keeping your transpulmonary pressure high. But if you have reached transpulmonary pressure of 20 and there is no recruitment, if you have transpulmonary pressure of 20 and 25 and there is no recruitment, okay, then there is not going to be further recruitment. There's going to be more injury here. So if you are not recruiting, you have only two options. One is prone, other is ECMO. You know, oxygen is not going to brother. One is prone, other is ECMO. You can't do anything more than that. Okay, you can't keep inflating and inflating because you will injure the lung. Clear on this? So I hope we've gone through recruitment. The next time, when we are going to talk about lung mechanics, we will also talk about transpulmonary pressure, strain, stress. I haven't even gone to it. Okay, strain, stress, transpulmonary pressure. What is it all about? We'll go to that esophageal manometry. We'll go to all of that the next time we do lungs again. But let's now divert the topic and let's. Is there any other doubts on recruitment? Today was the topic was only recruitment. Is there evidence that it improves outcome? No. But there are certain ventilation modes. There are certain ventilation modes that have shown to be superior in some studies. And one of that ventilation mode is APRV. Okay, adjustable pressure release ventilation. So this APRV is a ventilation mode which is basically a continuous recruitment, something like a staircase maneuver. It is a continuous recruitment. The pressures remain at 30, 30, 30, 30 all the time. Keep remains high all the time. That's what APRV is. Since it's a continuous form of recruitment, this has somehow in some studies showed an improvement in oxygenation, and some studies have also depicted an improvement in outcome. That's why APRV is the right mode in recruitment in ARDS or in COVID-19 ARDS. That's why APRV is the right mode. Unless you know how to, if you know to do APRV, all these things are perfect, because then it is actually like a staircase maneuver and it is a sustained recruitment. All the recruitment maneuvers are supposed to be ill-sustained. You must understand this. Recruitment maneuvers are usually ill-sustained. You have to treat the problem. Without treating the problem, these recruitment maneuvers may not help you. What did the PROSEVA study do? The PROSEVA study was the clear estimate of how recruitment maneuvers work. In PROSEVA study, what they did? In PROSEVA study was a study for proning patients. What did they do in PROSEVA study? They actually put the patient on a ventilator. After putting the patient on a ventilator and a satisfactory peep that the physicians felt, they waited for 12 to 24 hours. So when they waited for 12 to 24 hours and the oxygenation, if they improved, they did not prone these patients. That means you need to give time to recruitment strategies. If at 12 to 24 hours, the oxygenation improved, they didn't prone. But if at 12 to 24 hours, if the patient did not improve oxygenation, they prone that patient. So what it goes on to say, there are certain lungs that will open up quickly. There are certain lungs that will take time to open up. You have to figure out which are those lungs. So then, clear on this? Clear on this? Some lungs will just do a recruitment strategy and they will be tuck karke opened up. But there will be certain lungs that have done a recruitment strategy. For example, Lakshman Narvekar, you have opened up the lungs. Now in a couple of time, say 12 to 24 hours, if he again closes down his lungs and you have not done suction, you have not done or disconnection of the tube, what does this mean? That the recruitment maneuvers effect are not sustained. So such patients, if I again re-recruit them, it's not going to work. I need to prone these patients. You understand? Unless, for example, you have done a suction, you have disconnected the tube, something like that you have to done. Okay, then re-recruiting the lungs as per whatever we did is a good idea. But for example, if the patient just goes down on the oxygenation parameters, this particular patient who you have recruited, you have not increased the oxygen, you have not done anything like that. You have not suctioned, you have not increased fluid, you have not done all these things. Okay, then the option is that trial of that FRC may or increasing recruitment may not work. You may need to prone these patients. You understand? That's why if a patient has got PF ratio of less than 150, I would want to prone my patients at 12 to 24 hours. At 12 to 24 hours. You understand? Clear on this? So in short, if my compliance is already good, say it's 80. If my compliance is already 80, recruiting that lung may not be a good idea only. You will have to prone directly. It may not be recruitable only in the first place. It may not be something that you, because otherwise it's if compliance is 80 means it's easily recruitable. You know, if 80 means, if I even make PEEP of 4, what will be my increase in tidal volume? 320. Are you understanding? If I'll explain to you this again. If my patient's compliance is good, say it's 80, 80, compliance is good. Okay, 80. I go from 4 PEEP to 8 PEEP. What is the difference in PEEP? 4. When I make a difference of PEEP of 4 into 80, that is the compliance, is 320. So if my tidal volume is going to increase by 320 by just a small change of PEEP, okay, the oxygenation should improve. Isn't it? I'm improving my tidal, improving my FRC. Am I clear on this? But if it is not doing that, at that compliance of 80, I am increasing my PEEP from 4 to 8, but oxygenation is not improving. So what is my alternative? Prone. Because a highly compliant lung will respond very easily, will should respond ideally very easily to a small change in PEEP also. It doesn't require high PEEPs. You understand? Are you understanding? For example, a patient who comes from the operation theater, does not have ARDS. He doesn't have ARDS. The patient is just coming from the operation theater. They have done some surgery over there, and then they tried to extubate this patient, put the patient on TPs and made the patient breathe. The lower lobes of the lung collapsed. Under paralytic agent, the lower lung collapsed. Now the patient is not maintaining saturation. So they brought the patient to the OT, to the ICU. This patient, you increase the PEEP from 4 to 6 or even 4 to 8, immediately the lungs will recruit up. You got the point? Because he does not have ARDS. It will just recruit up. Once it recruits, it will sustain and cremate at that point. You don't need 20 PEEP and 15 to 25 PEEP for those, because they are not ARDS lungs. They are just lungs that have undergone some small amount of atelectasis without a capillary leak. There is no capillary leak. There is no fluid inside that lung. You know, in ARDS lung, there is a capillary leak and fluid is also there inside the lung. Clear on that? That's why that will take time. There's going to be take time for that ARDS patients. You understand? That's why 12 to 24 hours is the time limit we give to see whether there is any kind of improvement. So finding out the compliance after intubation is very, very important here. That is why in most, what we have found out is in COVID ARDS, the compliance pattern remains good in many patients. Since the compliance is good, that is why there is no point of recruitment. That is why proning is working in these cases. That's why we are proning these patients. Even awake, you're proning these patients because you're assuming that the compliance is probably okay. That's what we found out in COVID ARDS, that the compliance is pretty okay. And hence you prone these patients directly. Now you understood why we are proning these patients? Did you understand why you're proning the patients now? Because the compliance is okay. I don't have any leeway in recruitment strategy. So probably I'll just prone them. Right? So we've done recruitment strategies. It's 10:30. Let us see whatever time we have, whether we can do pancreatitis. That is the other part of the story. We will now move from recruitment. We'll go to pancreatitis. I will send you a fresh link. I will send you a fresh link right now. Please register on that. Okay.